segnet marvash mayon khasari kholda atit no
marvash mayon
Oh,
O Lord, you are the sweet fragrance who fills the whole world. You removed fear from Joseph's heart and confirmed the truth about Mary's conception. Accept our incense, fill our souls with joy, and grant rest to all the departed, that we may raise glory to and thanks to you now and forever. So who is Joseph of Nazareth? Who is Saint Joseph? Next week we'll be able to answer the question, what is Saint Joseph? A couple months ago we were discussing some of the preparations for the upcoming months. And someone said to me, Abuna, Genealogy Sunday is so boring. This gospel of just names. But what we're doing these 2 weeks are actually back to front. Next Sunday's Gospel is the first part of chapter 1 of St. Matthew. And the Gospel that we have today is actually the following part. The first question answers, who is St. Joseph? The second question next week is, what is St. Joseph in the plan of redemption? So the thing we want to emphasize today is who this man is. Because this chapter 1 of St. Matthew is the only place where we are given any understanding of this man. In the Gospel of St. Luke, he's mentioned as part of the birth of our Lord and taking his wife down for the census, down to Bethlehem. But other than that, we're not told anything. In this Gospel, we're told who he is and that he's a just man. So we've mentioned to you over these last weeks, this spiritual movement, which was common actually, or at least not uncommon, at the time of our Lord of the Anawi. Those who chose what we would call humility now, but they chose to be among the little ones of Israel, the poor, the oppressed, and those who were in recognition that everything they had depended upon God. And Joseph himself embraced this. John the Baptist was another one. We know there was an entire community at Qumran near the Dead Sea. And these individuals oftentimes committed themselves to celibacy, waiting for the day of judgment, waiting for the coming of the Lord. And this relationship between Mary and Joseph are the same. We saw a couple weeks ago in the Gospel of St. Luke that when the angel Gabriel speaks to her, and speaks about her having a child, her reaction is to say, but I do not know man. Though she's already married to Saint Joseph, she makes it clear, we intend to have no normal conjugal relations. We don't know why they actually were married. We just know that they were married and that they had both embraced this life of celibacy. So who is Saint Joseph? When we read the beginning of the Gospel of St. Matthew, remember that St. Matthew is writing for Jewish converts, people who come from the background of Israel to Christianity. When St. Mark writes for the Romans, his Gospel, he's writing for people who are coming from pagan background to Christianity. So one of the immediate differences we see as in the Gospel of St. Matthew, it's filled with prophecies. This was done so that this be fulfilled. This be done so that that be fulfilled. This was done this way so that as the prophet Isaiah said. And we see it in today's Gospel from the prophet Isaiah. Because he's trying to show to this Jewish population the basis for their faith. Because clearly the people who are listening to the Gospel of St. Matthew already believe. So one of the first things that we know in this first chapter of St. Matthew is that Matthew is explaining to the people in writing what they already believe in faith, that the Messiah was born of a virgin. Now, this doesn't affect the people of Rome as much as it affects the people of Judea. Because, of course, the title Son of David is one of the main titles of the Messiah, that he will be a descendant of King David. So the question becomes, if he's born of a virgin, then how is he the descendant and the son of David when he has no human father? Saint Joseph is integrated into the whole work of redemption as the son of David, which is why when the angel speaks to him in the dream, he addresses him as Joseph, son of David. He is given his official, in a sense, an official title as a blood descendant of King David. It's why this gospel begins, properly translated, as this is the manner that the generation of the Jesus Christ came about. Rather clumsy in English. So many times you'll see translations that will say, this is how the birth of Christ came about. Or this is how the generation, or how the conception of Christ came about. But that's not what the term says. Because what St. Matthew is doing in this first chapter is explaining to us how this Yeshua, this Jesus, born of a virgin, is also the Christ. So what you notice here in this very beginning of our gospel today is that unique in the entire New Testament, what it actually says in Greek is the generation of, with the article, the Jesus Christ. Now there may not seem to be much, except clumsy in English. But what St. Matthew is emphasizing is how this one reality of the child Jesus born to Mary is the exact same being, the exact same person who is also the Christ. So the proper translation of this line very clumsily says, but very precisely says, and this is the manner that the generation of the Jesus Christ came about. And then he tells you about Joseph. So the second thing we want to notice is to understand the stages in marriage for the people of Judea at the time. When the Jews married, there were two steps. One was the marriage, and the second was the party. You worked out among your families the marital agreement, and that's the actual marriage. So Mary and Joseph are married. They are husband and wife, though they're not living together. The second stage was the party, when the family and friends would go to the bride's home and bring her basically in a parade of great music and celebration and bring her to her husband's home, and she would begin to live with him, and then everybody whipped it up over the next 7 days. Which is why it came out. The wine ran out, because this didn't last one afternoon or an evening. This went on for days. So we haven't arrived yet at the party part. But Mary and Joseph are married. Sometimes it will say espoused or whatever, but they are truly married. Espoused in its true sense, not in the sense of an engagement. And because of this relationship, the two stages may be anywhere from a few months to even up to a year between the actual marriage taking place and then the actual celebration of the marriage. And during those months' time, because they were married, not that it happened often, but it happened often enough not to cause anyone any stir, is sometimes the woman would already be expecting a child before she went and lived with her husband. Nobody was scandalized by it because they're married. We just haven't had the party yet. So what's taking place with the Blessed Virgin Mary is that she's expecting, at this point, at least 3 months into her pregnancy, after having been down during the visitation with Elizabeth, helping with John's birth, she now clearly shows that she's expecting a child. But that's not the part that's surprising. This is why St. Matthew then tells us Joseph was a just man. Now, justice is a sense of being upright. Dikaios in the Greek, which is used in the sense of an awe, before the divine majesty, to stand in silence before the Lord because we recognize his infinite divinity. It's the reason why up until the 1970s we didn't talk in church, because we stood in awe before the divine mystery of the sanctuary, the altar, and of course the substantial presence of our Lord, body, blood, soul, and divinity that dwelt upon our altar. So this is the attitude of Joseph. It's why when I mentioned to you that I think that during the visitation, Joseph accompanied his wife. He certainly wanted to make sure he watched over during these months that she was gone on her own. It would have been inappropriate. She would never have just gone off on her own. Somebody certainly went with her, and it's very likely St. Joseph. A third point I'd like you to notice about the question is St. Joseph is probably 20 years old. We've all seen holy cards, I know, of the 80-year-old man and the young woman with him. But at least to me personally, I find it rather mind-boggling and impossible to imagine that God's providence would have subjected the Holy Family to the jokes that would have come about if you really had an 80-year-old man with a 16-year-old girl as a family. Would have happened now, and would have happened then. So it's most likely St. Joseph is part of this current of the annulling of the little ones of Israel, who embraces waiting for the day of the Lord, just like Mary did, and he's probably about 20. Remember, the gospel is about young people. Everything that's accomplishing the work of salvation are 20-somethings. And so Joseph is young, he is a carpenter, he works, he's waiting to bring his wife in, but during those at least 3 months, if he's with her in Ayin Karim, not only is he aware of the fact that she bears this child of God's divine mystery, but for 3 months now at least, he's been watching her begin to show. And as her pregnancy advances, this just man, standing in awe before God, waiting for the day of the Lord, is overwhelmed by the idea, how can I, Yosef, how can I possibly bring this divine mystery into my home? This is what Joseph's fear is, that I can't do this. This is overwhelming. His appreciation of what is taking place makes him feel totally overwhelmed by awe. That is the notion of fear, which comes up in this gospel. It's not terror, but it is being overwhelmed by awe of the majesty of what is being taken place and of what he is being asked to do. So the fourth point is to notice how the translations are often given of what St. Joseph decides to do. Because he's overwhelmed, his decision is, I can't do this. And so he decides in a way of separating from Mary, discreetly, so as not to humiliate her, but to separate from her all the same and to not go through with the second stage of the marriage. Sometimes it's translated in your modern translation, they'll say he decided to divorce her and put her away discreetly. Anyone who knows anything about divorce knows there's never anything discreet or quiet about divorce. So that's obviously not the proper word to use to translate the gospel. Apolousai, the Greek word which is used, is actually the notion of separating or detaching, or separating a bond. And this is the term which is used. His decision is to separate from her. He's separating himself from her, to separate from her, but to do this as quietly as possible. In other words, we'll make sure that the invitations don't get sent out for the next part. And hopefully everyone will kind of forget about the party that we haven't had. And we'll continue this way. He'll take care of her in her own home. He'll make sure she's supported. But there's no way I can bring this divine mystery into my house. And that is the state of things when the angel appears to him at night. He's not revealing to him that this child is from God. He is revealing to him that you must not have fear, Joseph, son of David. You must adopt this child, for it's true that he is born and conceived of the Holy Spirit. But you shall take, son of David, you shall take Mary, your wife, into your home. Do not be overwhelmed. Do not fear. Take the next step and bring her, as you're supposed to do, into your household. And we're told that Joseph immediately reacts when he awoke the next morning and immediately puts it all into place. But the last point to note is what St. Matthew does in the prophecy of Isaiah. In order to explain this generation of the Jesus Christ, he takes the prophecy from Isaiah that the angel says in the dream, that a virgin shall conceive and shall bear a son, and this son will be named Emmanuel. Now what in the prophecy of Isaiah says, it says this virgin, this young woman, she shall name this child Emmanuel. St. Matthew tweaks the prophecy in order to encompass Joseph within the prophecy. He tweaks it by saying, and they shall call him Emmanuel. And Joseph is told, you are the one who must name this child. You adopt him. He is your son. We use this term foster father. It's true that Joseph is an adopted father biologically. He's not the biological father of Jesus. But for the Jewish people listening to this, he is no less real a father to this Messiah than if he had actually generated and fostered his conception. You are the one who is to name him. St. Matthew tweaks the prophecy of Isaiah. And we're told that Joseph awakes the child. He takes Mary, his wife, into his home. And then the quotation that I gave you, and he did not know his wife till she brought forth her firstborn son. Don't worry about the word until. I can do an all-day sermon on that. We're not going to do it. We'll be here forever. What it's telling you is that he brought her into the home. They still had no relations, period. It's not telling you anything happened after. It's just saying they continued in the same celibate manner they had before. And she brought forth her firstborn son. Not just son. This child has legal status in the law of Moses. Oftentimes they drop firstborn, just thinking son is sufficient. This child has a legal status whether there's any other child after him. Firstborn does not mean there's a second and a third and a fourth. Firstborn means precisely by the law, this is the child who is in the law in a special privileged place. So he does not know her, he brings her into her house, does not know her, they continue in this other relation, and she brings forth her legal firstborn son, and he names the child Yehoshua. God is salvation. So who is Saint Joseph? He is a young man, full of life, with an even fuller life of devotion to God. And that devotion is what fostered the awe of why he first stumbled in a sense, or had his doubts about taking the second stage of his marriage. He is named as the patron of our parish. May the intercession of Saint Joseph, this young man full of life, brought into the incorporated into the work of redemption, in his humility and in his glory, may he pray for us, intercede for us, and teach us to have the same attitude of awe before the majesty of God, but at the same desire to accomplish God's will, come what may. May his prayers be to us a rampart always. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We believe in one God.
All things is born in his soul. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ. Father, you are true
ever sure and hope that never fails. Grant love, happiness, and everlasting peace to your children here before you. Make us worthy to give one another the greeting of peace with pure hearts and souls, and with a holy kiss worthy of your blessed name, that we may raise glory to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
And so Ανθρωφαϊκών βαθλοψαγίε με τεξέου με τίελ. Χωσ όιον χαβε βοχόε τα παραν αμή. Ο χανό αλκόσο τανσίχο μεν χαμρό μεν μαϊό.
Especially Francis, the Pope of Rome, Bishop Peter, our Patriarch of Antioch, Nisrala Peter, our retired patriarch, Gregory John, our bishop, and all bishops. With them, we remember the priests, the deacons, and all who serve the church. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace and stability of the whole world, for a blessed and prosperous year, for an abundant harvest, for the sick and the oppressed, for all who call upon your holy name, on land, at sea, or in the air, and who profess that you are the true God, we pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, those who have presented the offerings upon this altar, and those who desire to do so but were unable. Grant them their petitions. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We remember all the saints, the fathers, prophets, apostles, martyrs, and confessors. Mary, the Mother of God, St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Maron, St. Charbel, St. Joseph, and all the righteous and the just, through their prayers, make us worthy to stand among them. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, in your grace, those who have left us and have gone to you from the first Christian disciples to this day. They were signed with the seal of baptism, received the precious body and blood of your Son. They wait for you in your life-giving hope. Raise them up for the last day.
Power and glory are yours, now and forever.
Deliver us, O Lord, from every temptation, and from the harm of evil. For you have power over all, and we raise glory to you, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who gives life to those who partake of it, and receive the blessing from you.
O Lord, in your grace and abundant mercy, bless those who bow before you. Make us worthy to share in your life-giving mysteries and to join the assembly of your saints, that with them we may raise glory to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity. One holy God,
one holy Son, one holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth, to him be glory forever.
Make us worthy, O Lord God,
so
Gracious God and Father, how can we repay you for your goodness and for the salvation you have just given us? Who can give you the glory you truly deserve? In our weakness and insofar as we are able, we worship, praise, and thank you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you. Jesus Christ, our Lord and God, we worship, thank, and praise you. We implore your goodness and abundant mercy for the salvation of the whole world, for the protection of the living and eternal rest to the departed, for the feeding of the hungry and the support of the needy, for the visiting of the sick and the consolation of the grieving. Through your grace, dwell in them, and by your abundant mercy, give them life. By your cross, bless your people, and protect your inheritance. Adoration is due to you, to your Father, and to your holy and life-giving Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The Mouse and the Miracle. Long ago, when I was just a small mouse, I had big dreams of traveling to faraway lands to see the sights. But being so small, I knew that I needed some assistance on my quest. Along the roadside one day, I met a nice couple, Joseph and Mary. They offered me some of their food and asked me if to join them on their trip. I hopped in their bag and our journey began. Joseph and his wife, Mary, were very kind to me and to others as well. They shared whatever they had and helped whomever they could. One night, Mary was very tired. Joseph asked several innkeepers for room, but every place we went was full. I could tell Joseph was worried because Mary was going to have a baby very soon.
One innkeeper finally told them that they could sleep in his stable if they didn't mind staying with the animals. Mary and Joseph were so grateful. During that magical night, the most amazing thing happened. Mary gave birth to a beautiful baby boy. All the animals watched with wonder as she swaddled him in cloth and laid him in a manger. While I sat by the manger looking at this tiny infant, I heard the most beautiful music. I looked up and saw that the sky was filled with angels singing of the birth of a king. A short while later, a group of shepherds arrived at the stable to see a baby. They were so overjoyed that they left right away to spread the good news.
Three kings from the east visited the baby Jesus, bringing him the most wonderful gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. I too should share this wonderful news. Every Christmas since, I travel to homes near and far to share the good news about the greatest gift that was given to us on that day, Jesus. Every day you can find me somewhere in your home. When you do, think of me, my amazing adventures. Be kind and helpful to everyone, and you know, just like Mary and Joseph, remember that gifts are supposed to be shared, and Jesus is our gift to share with everyone. Jesus is the best gift of all.
There is a letter from the eparchy explaining the next 3 weekends Because of the way the calendar works this weekend, we have holy days and Sundays slamming all into each other. So you have a letter there, so please take them home. And of course the Maronite voices also come in this week, so please take those. We thank the beautiful children for what you did so well this morning. And go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.